the ability to properly extract and manipulate data is extremely important when we're talking about software development. Database management and putting databases together and organizing data is a field all to itself, and I have done extensive study in that area. And yet, when putting software applications together and putting the basis of a system in place, the way the data is structured and organized, in my opinion, and I would say that a guy by the name of Mike Acton, you could find him on YouTube and other areas. He spoke one year at CPPCon, right? It's a conference for C++ development, where he made the case for data as a huge impact on software and the efficiency of systems. I've seen that in my own work, and I've seen how when data is the foundation, because think about it, you got this program, right? Okay, it's a window, and you're clicking in this window. But behind the scenes, it's going across the network, and it's accessing a database. So you got all this data here, right? Now, this program here could be organized extremely well, developed very well. The screens are laid out very well. But if you have any kind of bog down right here, right, that's going to influence this. And so I found ways through the work that I've done to optimize software applications by putting the priority, the absolute priority, on the organization of data, not just in databases, but in the flow of data all the way through, right? And so you want to make sure that you have data properly in place. That being said, what impact does the computer have on the person who is putting data together, who is organizing data, who is putting data designs in place and structuring tables, views, indexes, all those sorts of things? In this particular take, I will look at installing Microsoft SQL Server on a low-end computer, because what is the general perception out there? That SQL Server, at least this was the perspective in the past, it may have evolved a little bit, but SQL Server requires a somewhat beefy machine, somewhat sizable machine in terms of processor, RAM, hard drive capacity, and the design of the system itself, the system board, and the interconnects. And that is absolutely true in a server environment where you have multiple people accessing the database for real in a production situation. But to what extent does that apply at the local level where the person who is putting the system together needs a really great machine in order to achieve things with data? Let's take a look at what SQL Server installation looks like on a low-end computer. Okay, so we begin by downloading SQL Server from Microsoft's website. So the easiest way to get there is do a Google search for Microsoft SQL Server download. Usually the first link would be good, but here that's not the case. But we'll scroll down until we see a link that is legitimate, and then that takes us to the download page for Microsoft SQL Server. I'm choosing the developer edition because that's going to be the most full-featured edition of SQL Server that we can use. The download file is simply a starter file. It gives us the option to install directly from the web or to download all the install files locally to the computer. I've chosen that latter option
simply because if there's an interruption in the internet connection while trying to install SQL Server, that could cause us a lot of issues, and we would have to start all the way over. But if you download the entire set of install files and that process completes successfully, then not only do you end up with an uninterrupted installation process, but you can reapply that install to multiple machines and not really worry about having internet connectivity on all those machines, at least in the initial part of the setup. So the download succeeded, and at this point I'm going to close out of this window here and shut down the computer. And when I was doing this, I did it over 2 days. So the first day I downloaded the files, and then on the second day I triggered the install. And so now we've entered into the second day, and we're going to find that installation that I had downloaded on the previous day. So I'm going to go to the downloads folder, and we're going to find that executable. It's labeled SQL Server 2019 X64. ENU stands for English, and then DEV for development. And then we'll go into a folder where it extracted it to and run the setup. And all this setup process does is open up a dashboard. SQL Server installs have used a dashboard approach for quite some time now. I think that may have started with SQL Server 2005. We'll have to go back and check. But basically, you go into the installation node on this dashboard, and you select the option to do a new SQL Server installation. And so once you click that, the installation process initializes behind the scenes. And while we wait for this initialization process to finish, just a few things to keep in mind. You really want to choose the developer option for the install, and you can do this without having internet information services installed. I know in times past you needed internet information services, but with these later versions of SQL Server, I think starting around the 2017 edition, it may have been a little bit before then, you no longer needed internet information services since they decoupled the reporting services installation from the main SQL Server installation. So it's checking the computer, it's checking the environments, it's checking the prerequisites to ensure that there are no issues that would block the install of SQL Server or cause issues for a successful SQL Server install. While that's running, I'm going to look at some performance statistics and see what the performance on this machine looks like while this process is taking place. And as you can see from the CPU breakdown, the CPU is pegged at 100% constantly. So not much to learn from there. And we see that the installation check has finished, and we are good to go to install SQL Server. I'm going to play around with a few options. A quick option here is to do select all and then unselect the option you don't want. That's generally going to be the best way to go about it. And while I was going through this, I was not sure if I wanted to install R or Python into the SQL Server instance. But after much thought, I decided to go ahead and integrate that in. And my concern there was that having too many components on this machine would bog the machine down. But I noticed that while I was looking at the CPU performance breakdown, that the computer itself, despite what it was showing in the breakdown, is actually performing just fine. As you can see on these screens, I'm clicking through menu options, I'm scrolling through. There's no lag here. And so everything looks good from the standpoint. So I did decide to go ahead and keep all of the features for SQL Server installation except Java, right? I am more interested in C Sharp, C++, and C integration. And so I'm going to click Next. The options are now set in the installation sequence. And now we have to tell SQL Server how we want it to be installed. Do we want it to be a default instance, a named instance? What kind of security we're going to need? Are we going to do just strict Windows authentication only, or are we going to require an SA account? I know that there are various techniques out there for just doing Windows authentication only, and they are highly recommended, especially when you're looking at trying to create a chain of custody, a chain of authorization to know what was accessed and by whom and in what way. But I think having an SA account, a dedicated SA account, is useful and vital because with that dedicated SA account, what you end up with is the ability to integrate heterogeneous software applications more easily. And so we've come a long way when it comes to the use of Windows authentication with diverse programming languages and platforms, but it's not 100%. And so having the ability to access the database through through named accounts, and I'm not suggesting that you would connect to the database with with an SA account, but having this configuration set this way makes that much easier. And so we want to basically set that same type of authorization pattern on our other nodes, right? And here we see the port settings for the integration services, right? And so if you have if you're using integration services in your applications, this is a great opportunity to make sure that's set up correctly. And so we've gone through and we've established various settings. One thing about SQL Server compared to many years ago is the integration of open source technology and the open source tools and features and components. And so you have to accept that license here. Because you're merging two worlds here, the proprietary and the open source worlds, right? And so Microsoft has found a way to marry those two. And so I will accept that because I am definitely pro open source. And then we just continue on next. And we're going to do this for Python as well. We do have a bit of a wait here as we wait for the Python screen to initialize, but go ahead and accept that. And we are go on the Microsoft R capabilities as well as the Python capabilities for this install of SQL Server. So we have a little bit of a hiccup here, and it's not something that happened on our part, but to set up the machine learning server, the components here were not automatically downloaded when we did the offline setup for the SQL Server. If you remember back in the beginning, we did the SQL Server install in such a way where it was to download the entire set of files that we need to install SQL Server offline. But there are a few files that we have to download ourselves, and so I took those links and I put them into Notepad so I can have them readily available. And then I will just copy each link one at a time, go into the browser, right click, and choose paste and go, which will resolve to wherever those files are on the server, on Microsoft servers, and cause it to download to the downloads folder. So, you know, we step through those files one by one until we have all four files in place. The downloads themselves are not too bad. It's a relatively quick download, and so we essentially are able to obtain all four files in a short period of time. And then once the final file is downloaded, we can exit out of the web browser, and then we'll go back to the install screen and choose the folder where these four files reside. The system, the installation system here will then discover that those files do exist with the proper file names and the proper contents. And right here, I'm going to right click, copy that location, and then I found that copying that made no difference at all. You do have to click that browse button, and you have to manually select where those files reside. But once we're good to go on that, the next button then becomes available, and then we can click the install button, and this is the SQL Server install on a computer running a Pentium processor with 4 gigabytes of RAM. This install process is going to take a bit of time, and so at various points I'm going to fast forward through the total install. So earlier, if we just do a quick recap, we downloaded SQL Server and we did it in such a way where the installation files were downloaded to the computer. And then I came back later on another day, and I installed SQL Server, right? That's what we're doing now. Earlier, we had selected options. We had selected options for our install, how we wanted the database to be installed, and what were the parameters of that install, the security options as well. That entire process took about 28 minutes, right? So if you look in the lower right-hand corner, that's the clock, right? It shows the time, the date and the time. And so if you take the time from when we first started the install, right, which was about 12:19 a.m. And we did our final options and we click next to kick off this screen that we're seeing here, at 12:47 a.m. we're at about 28 minutes there. So this process here of actually installing the database, because that's what's happening here, is we set all the options and now the install program is putting the database on the system. And that entire process takes about 21 minutes, right? So although I am accelerating this process in terms of the video, that's what the total time was, 21 minutes. And that seems like a lot of time. And I will say that if I look at it, right, I've been doing SQL Server installs for the better part of 20 to 24 years. And I can say that when they changed to this format, in terms of how the install is presented visually, the length of time is generally about the same, regardless of what type of process you have. If we're talking about the higher end processors, the ones that have the suffix H, the capital H suffix on the model number of the processor, the install could go much faster there. But when we're talking about all the other processors, the ones that have the suffix capital U at the end of the name, at the end of the model number, and all the processors below that, then the installation time can be very similar in terms of the time. You might save, 5 minutes on one versus the other. But there is enough going on with the SQL Server installation, right? There's actually a command line process that you can do. Or you could ra rather, you can open up the command prompt and you can kick off the SQL Server installation from the command prompt once you have the files downloaded, right? So instead of doing that install visually, at least entirely, right? You would have this command prompt window open in the background, and it will show you the actual play-by-play of what's actually going on. See here, we only see a green progress bar. When you're in Microsoft Windows, you see these green progress bars. When it's doing something, in different programs, you got this progress bar, and at least since Windows Vista, although Vista's progress bar may have been luminescent blue, but they've used this green bar for since Vista or 7, and then since then it's always been a green progress bar. But this progress bar and the little text that you see right below it shows you some things. But when you have this command prompt window open up in the background, you see so much text scrolling through. It's amazing, right? There's so much code and execution that's going on, that's taking place when you're installing SQL Server. But I actually like this progress bar because who wants to see a big scroll of text, right? I mean, sometimes you do, but not in this case, because SQL Server is one of the most robust software systems that Microsoft puts in place. It absolutely has to be, right? We can tolerate significant bugs in other types of software, other software tools, But this is the one software, this is the one software that Microsoft paying customers buy, whether it's for pay or it's for free. This is the one type of software that you cannot have show-stopping bugs, significant bugs, because this is the software that manages the data. This is where all the HR records are going to go. This is where all the credit card information is going to go. This is where all the inventory information, every single product, every single SKU number, every single model number, cross-referenced to all of the purchase histories of all of the customers, cross-referenced to all of the postal addresses for those different customers, and that may be cross-linked to the transportation tables for the most efficient routes to deliver to those customers. Everything is going to be stored in a database, and this software system, in this case, this one is from Microsoft. We know that others exist. You got the ones from Oracle, you got the ones from IBM, you got Postgres SQL, you have MySQL, and you have all kinds of databases out there. But no matter the brand name, no matter what type it is, that's how the economy actually operates. It operates out of these databases. And that's why this video is so darn long, because that's how important this piece of system is. And then you build software applications on top of this data, right? And so this SQL Server tool is the tool, at least for Microsoft applications, where all the code kind of harmonizes together, right? If you're building software screens using Microsoft tools, they integrate more easily with the Microsoft SQL Server database, because Microsoft made that whole system easy from a programming standpoint. But the data, it sits alone. It sits as files, right? And these files that contain this data, those files have to be maintained properly at all times. If you end up with file corruption, the data is lost. Well, not 100%. And that's why we have experts who study data recovery and all this. But, if you're not a major corporation with money that you've invested into having your data duplicated in real time, backed up in real time, you have multiple copies of it, so that if you do end up with damage to the data files on one of the computers, one of the servers, but you can easily recover that within, let's say, a couple of minutes, because you got these top tier DBAs or database administrators, database professionals, who can do the miraculous. If you're a mid-sized business, you're a small business, and you're still using this same kind of software system, right? You're just using it at a mid-tier or a SOHO small business level. You may have like weekly backups, and you got this e-commerce site running off of this database, or you got partners that are sending you data files, and they're doing it in real time, and then there's this web portal connected to the database, and something happens to that database, you could literally go out of business, right? And so that's how vital this data is. The software can crash. Your software programs that you make or that you buy from a third party or that you download for free off the web and you put your own branding and logo on it, those programs can crash all day long. You can have bugs in those. I don't suggest that you do. And I don't like that way of going about things. But if that's what you want, that's great. People have differences of opinion. But the one thing that nobody has a difference of opinion whatsoever at all, no matter what, is that your data got to be intact, and it has to be right. It has to be accurate. And so that's how vital a tool like this is. That's what SQL Server is. It's the tool for managing the data and presenting it to software developers so that they can then present that through software applications in fancy ways, right? With beautiful fonts and icons, or the ability to double-click on rows in a table or grid or cell or a data field, right? And then when you click the submit button or whatever button you click, or if you have, automatic save going on the screen, behind the scenes, though, that information that's being collected on that data entry screen or on that grid or whatever, all of that is then routed by way of the software application, which coordinates this. It all gets issued back to the database, right? And laid into the proper format on the database for permanent eternal keeping. And then there's the opportunity to modify the data, right? And you're going to go through a database system to do that. And when you're working, at the level of Google or Facebook or Amazon.com, you might not actually use a system like this. You might use something that has greater scalability, greater reach for billions of users, right? I don't think you're going to use SQL Server or Oracle on billions of users in real time. Maybe you can, maybe you do, but I know that traditionally that really wasn't the case, right? They tend to scale to maybe tens of thousands or maybe a couple of 100,000 users at the maximum. But that's still significant for a corporation, for an internal part of the company, or for managing, your permanent record of what's happening on the website. But when you're at the internet scale, you're using something different. But the same basic premise that I started this conversation with still applies. The quality, the safety of that data is paramount. Facebook.com could crash. The feeds program, right? The app on the phone, it could totally glitch out. And you have to uninstall it, reinstall it, or maybe you're just having a bad day with what the programmers put out on the app. But the user profile, the social graph, whatever it is, that has to still be intact. That still has to work. Because the app can change. It can be different from week to week, month to month, year to year. But that data, once you establish that format, that's an internal format in most cases. And the information that was entered has to be the same information. So if you typed dog 123 into a data field, and when it's saved onto the database, it needs to be dog 123. It can't be dog 456, because the difference between dog 123 and dog 456, critically important. And when you apply that to real world things like social security numbers, driver's license numbers, medical, health savings accounts numbers, you name it, employee numbers, employee personnel file numbers, all of that. And you get those numbers wrong, you are now exposing people's data. You're now exposing what somebody hope is private between you and the internet service provider and other customers. That's private. But if you have a hiccup because the data got screwed up, you got data corruption in the file, then customer A, their information is now seen by customer B, and now you have a data breach of your own making, right? And tools like SQL Server, Oracle Database, all of that, they provide the structure that if you use it properly, either between the database administrator and the software developers, or when those roles are one and the same person, right? I've been in many jobs where I've had to be a database administrator and software developer and system architect all at the same time. Those are great gigs. You learn a lot, you accomplish a lot. Sometimes you accomplish a lot more in a shorter amount of time. But the important thing there is that the principles of proper database management and data management and taxonomy and information architecture are observed and applied, right? And so that's kind of the big picture on databases, right? And I think before the 1970s, there really wasn't any significant database software tools, right? IBM, from what we're all told, IBM initiated or inaugurated the database era, right? And so there was research done at IBM on a structured query language, or what we all, nobody really says that. Nobody really says structured query language. We all say SQL, right? And the SQL language that emerged out of IBM and became an ANSI standard, we owe a great debt to IBM. So this 21-minute install is now finished, right? And so we're at the very end here. It's actually doing a cleanup process here. So, but based on the status screen, everything is done. And this is the final screen. It just shows us the result of the installation process. And this is the quality check on the part of the database administrator or the software developer who has the database installed, to see that everything went through as planned, right? And in this case, it did. And so now we're just going to hop over and do the reporting services installation. This is not necessary for the function of the database, but I like having SQL Server reporting services around, right? And it's just going to be a very quick install, and we're not going to spend very much time on that, but especially when you're doing you're working with the database locally on your machine, like we're doing here, the benefit of reporting services is that if you're working in an environment where that's the tool that they use, right, then being able to develop those reports on your machine and test them out and make sure that they look right, they're formatted right, that sort of thing, before you deploy them to a production server is vitally important. And that's the benefit you're going to gain from having SQL Server reporting services on your machine, to the extent that you are involved with creating reports. And reports are not just for the accounting department or the HR department, right? You could legitimately use this reporting tool in other applications. It's basically a way of automating the formatting of data from a database, where you have repeating information and you want it in a tabular or matrix format. Now, this next download and install, this one is vitally important. SQL Server Management Studio, or what the real true OGs of SQL Server would once called Enterprise Manager, right? I used Enterprise Manager long ago, somewhere in the late 90s, early 2000s, but I don't qualify as an OG. But anyway, Microsoft eventually retired that whole Enterprise Manager tool set and came up with SQL Server Management Studio. And SQL Server Management Studio was its own software application for connecting to the SQL Server database, right? Because you have to remember these SQL Server database, it's not visual software. It's just a pure server software for managing data. You can access it through the command line, right? You can do that all day long. this visual tool is simply an easier way to access the database and manage it through visual tools. But at some point, Microsoft switched from having SQL Server Management Studio be like its own standalone application and be, I think it still is a standalone application, but it's more like a Visual Studio style application now, you know, whereas, you know, before it was like just this, it was a distinct program in its own right in terms of how it was visually designed and how it was built and constructed. At some point, again, something is telling me that SQL Server 2017, it might have been a little bit before that, but I think somewhere around in that era, they switched to like a Visual Studio. Visual Studio is not only for building software applications, on the Microsoft platform, and then you got Visual Studio Code, which is, cross-platform. You know, that's a whole other different topic. But Visual Studio is also, they also have this thing called Visual Studio Shell. So if the mechanics of how you manage like a project and how you access multiple files and do it the way that you see it represented in Visual Studio, you could tap into that. To do so. So we have finished the install of SQL Server Management Studio. And let's close out our installation windows for SQL Server, the database engine proper. And then I'm going to restart real quick. And then we're going to launch SQL Server itself. But before I do that, I want to pin some of these shortcuts to the main start menu. If you look at the other video about optimizing Windows 11, quick, simple tips to do that, you see that I fully customized the start menu in order to optimize, speed up my workflow. Because who wants to scroll down their start menu all the time, right? I don't like doing that. I like to click once and have a heads-up display, click on what I need, right? And I'm actually being pretty restrained here because in my true setup when I'm working on Windows, I also pin icons to the taskbar, right? So we've launched SQL Server Management Studio, and it's going to take about a minute or two for the initial screen to load up. This is the first time it's loading, and it has to do some initialization work to get ready. The great thing about this process, running it on this computer, is we get to see what is our tolerance level for, you know, how long things take. And like I said, this only took about a minute, right? It may have been less than a minute. And there's the login screen for SQL Server. We just go right in there, click OK, because we're using Windows authentication. You know, we set it up with the SA account, you know, right? The server administrator account. We set it up with that, but we didn't use that to log in. We used my currently logged in Windows credential to do so. I'm just going to create a new database. Right off the bat, and I'm just going to give it a name, a generic name. You know, the name here doesn't matter, but if you have naming standards in a professional situation, you definitely want to adhere to those. Also, if you do, and I just want to breeze through the options just to see what the options look like in this version of SQL Server. And basically, they look pretty much the same as they have for the last five or seven versions. But sometimes they throw a new option in here, and it's just interesting to pay attention to that. But this screen right here, the file groups, extremely important. File groups are extremely important. If you want to take the fundamental performance of the SQL database instance to its zenith. File groups are a major component of that. But there are YouTube videos for that. I don't cover that here. So here we're going to create a table. We're going to do it visually. I'm going to just create an ID column. We want to use the largest integer type that we can. Well, not quite. We'll just go with big int in this case. You don't want the biggest, because then you have data structuring issues at scale anyway. We're going to set this set the identity on this so it auto increments. And I want to set this as the primary key column. So I'm going to toggle that option. So now we have it as a primary key that automatically creates a primary key index behind the scenes. Then I'm going to throw in another field, and this is, you might say it's our surrogate key, the key that we actually want to use when we query the database. And then just refer to the ID column, for example, when doing our joins, our inner joins, left and right outer joins, right? And because that's going to give you, better performance and better access efficiency using the B-tree index, right, behind the scenes. But so that's just a drop and a hint on a technique for accessing the data. I don't like null columns. I use them when I have to, but I avoid them when I can. And let's expand the... Let's expand, and let's just do a comparison here. Look at how Microsoft names their tables, right? And I agree with that naming scheme. Lowercase, all lowercase with underscores. Now, some people are going to differ on that, and they're going to want to use camel case or Pascal case, right? But I actually like that format. Notice I renamed the database. It's easy to do visually, but that doesn't cause a ripple rename of your indexes and other database objects that you created prior to the renaming of the database. And so you have to go in there and adjust those accordingly. So this is demonstrating the flexibility of being able to do that, but production scenarios, you want to avoid that. So that's kind of our run through a SQL Server. Look at the CPU statistics. There's still a lot going on behind the scenes, but I think this was a pretty good end result.